So what are the rainbows of your life then? What overwhelms you? I'm coming with this question because just a moment ago we had a huge rainbow over the sky, and all like children we just dropped everything and we ran to see the rainbow and take pictures. It was an extraordinary moment which sort of took all our attention, took all our wonder, and it was really the moment. So these sort of things happen to us. What is happening to you, or what are you finding in your life that gives you such a sense of wonder?
You know, I kind of managed by a series of accidents, I managed to pass from the playful childhood into playful adulthood. So there was like a series of beautiful accidents that allowed me to prolongate my childhood till this moment of my life. So I have people around me that gives me the permit, or my job gives me a permit to play and experiment and try to find a new creative connections. It, regardless if it is an art or physical education, or if it is kind of helping other people to become more creative in their job. So somehow I'm very pleased and probably also lucky that I'm able to play till this age of my life and surround all that I'm doing around the play. And the funny thing is, you know, that we perceive play as interruption, as this kind of islands in our serious lives. And I just don't understand why we shouldn't be playing more often, no matter what kind of jobs we have. I think we've been articulating this in mentorship a lot. These first two kind of elements of what Fighting Monkeys build on is how we can love more life. And even if this sounds so spectacular, how we can love more life, but you know, loving life is really the kind of substance out of which things they start to grow. And loving life means being creative about the life, having this kind of freshness of a child, right? This freshness, okay, there is the rainbow and we give ourselves time to go and see it. And then of course the second part in that playfulness, in that childhoodness, is that we need to have a capacity to solve life challenges that we meet in everyday life. And so we need some, have some cognitive or physical, and they're used and they're usually combined, some tools that allow us to overcome the troubles that come across our paths.
What I found really interesting, having been exposed to Fighting Monkey practice, is that playfulness has been merged with athleticism, sort of really a high performance athleticism. How did you come up with this idea to connect the two seemingly almost unrelated worlds? Creativity almost belongs to art. Sports performance or athleticism is something which we probably tend to do with a little bit of a sense of training, sense of achievement, power, progression. And playfulness is something almost light.
Mm-hmm. So I had this opportunity when I was younger. I was playing sports. But then that period kind of finished when I was like very young, and then I slowly transitioned to art. So these were two worlds. In the world of sports, you need to compete, you need to win, and this is what is praised. You have to have a perfect technique. You look for some kind of efficiency. On the other hand, there is this artistic world within which everything unmeasurable plays really important and significant role. You have no this aim, you do not want to achieve anything in particular. It is rather you allowing a unpredictable events to happen. You give them freedom to some kind of unexpected encounters. And this happened to me several times. So there was a sport, there was an art. There was a sport again, and there was an art again. And from art I went again into a sport. So this oscillation between these two worlds allowed me to create, or it gave me a freedom to navigate myself as I like. Whatever tool I see, I use. And I use it in kind of, some people say it creative way. I don't find myself necessarily creative. It's just that I see another opportunities in the objects that we have around ourselves. We've been working, for example, with the belts. Okay, so, you know, like, I've been working with judokas, I've been working with some grapplers, etc. So this belt wall was always around, but it was never used for building up a strength or building up a more adaptive games within which we could find how we can rehabilitate, how we can find more range of motion, how we can find more strength, more adaptive strength through playfulness rather than through training and exercise. You know, training and exercise can get you only to a certain level, but everyone eventually gets bored. So how we can get that athlete to live a little bit longer with a little bit less injuries, right? Even if he wants to be the world champion, and the, really the schedule is so tight, the demand is so huge, how you can play around, do not lose that creative fuel to kind of chase their dreams. But not only talking about athletics, but talking about also our normal life. We have tools around to play with, but we are not looking on them with the fresh eyes, you know? So this is a cab and that's it. But you have an opportunity to look at that cab in a kind of slightly different way. And children are really good at that. So if you tell to a child, this is a cab, they use it only as a cab. But if you tell them, oh, what is this object? Do you know how I could use it? They will come up with many different ways of usage, and that's creativity.
It's beautiful how the human potential to create, or our ability to look at things from another angle, is merged with the physical practice that we are having. And the words that I often hear, and even in this conversation, is the role of unmeasurable, or the unexpected encounters, or the uncertainty which happens. This has to do a lot with creative situations or sort of life situations. And suddenly we bring this perspective into training. And you also talk about earthquake architecture. I wonder if it's not a sort of a revolutionary perspective to actually sports training. When we train sports, when we aim for higher performance, simply just losing weight, we so often take measurable, expected, certain ways. And here you almost go for the opposite. So what's the rationale behind it?
Well, everyone seems to have some kind of very special ingredients. Every coach has a special ingredients how to get their athletes up to the peak. I don't want to talk only about athleticism, and what I have seen and what I have realized is really that this kind of design programs, these protocols, just do not fit into a complexity of the world, complexity of the life that each individual lives, right? You can build up protocols for very stable environments, or you can build up protocols for people if they have to operate a machine, right? But we do not operate in a machine. We do not have the body. We are the body, so to say. I understood this rule-based program. This is the best program for this. This is the best program for that. Doesn't really reflect anything. It is more like this industrialized education where we need to create one model that fits for many, many people. And then you are thinking, okay, so why is it so popular? Why everyone is looking for protocols? This is protocol for healing the hips. This is protocol for healing the shoulders. I really find it a really stupid idea, but because we are different biological constitutions, right? We have to pay attention to the particular human being, the context within which that is just very complicated, because you are existing in a very unique environment that is very difficult for me to understand. How I can claim that with that protocol you will be healed? You are not a machine, right? So, but it is very good economical model. That means that if I use a protocol and everyone kind of agrees that that protocol is very good and it somehow works for, I don't know what is really the data behind it, but if it somehow works, it works very well. What I'm interested in meeting that person. So I'm interested in meeting you and try to understand what is the context within which you operate, what is your history, what is your present situations, of course also where you are heading. And what we will be doing together, we will be playing together, we will be discovering what are the possible, not the most effective pathways, but most creative pathways for your very special situation, so we can get there by maybe not abusing your body, right? But maybe discovering what are the better rhythmical qualities, what are better attitude towards what you are doing. So this is something that I am very much interested in. And it seems like I have a lot of energy to spend time with people. I really love to communicate with people. I really like to hear them. I really like to see them, how they are moving, what is their interest. And so I think that program or the development is happening through the dialogue, is happening with something in between, right? It's not from me giving it, it's given to you. We have to co-create that kind of dialogue. Otherwise, no healing can happen, no progress can happen, to my understanding.
I'm sometimes asked, what is the best system? What is the best program to keep you young, to keep you strong, to keep you performing as long as you can? And one of the possible answers is probably the program which keeps you going long enough, which keeps you motivated, which keeps you open-minded, which keeps you attentive to the change which needs to happen. So for example, with Fighting Monkey practice, there was never a time when I felt like I have done it all, or that I'm bored, or that we are repeating ourselves so much. Although at the same time, we speak so much of taking a journey back, a return journey, and also articulating our joints in very slow motion and actually repeating some things. As we're talking here about the role of playfulness and creativity, finding the newness or the new aspects in motion, the new games, we also witness in our practice how much value is given to repetitiveness, which, like you formulate, is a way for us to know ourselves.
If you say, like, in the center of fighting monkey practice is what? We were saying, okay, loving life means being creative about the life, being kind of fresh, having energy surplus to play with, you know, not being in an energetical crisis all the time. We were saying, okay, we need to also be able to solve life challenges. If creative life is meaning supporting life, means water supports life. And if we talk about solving life challenges, we are talking more about the carbon. We are talking about the structures that can support the life. And then, of course, naturally, we would be asking ourselves, what is it that makes life going? And we would say, biologically, there are these eight major functions, and it's like maintaining boundaries, movement, responsiveness, digestion, metabolism, excretion, growth, and reproduction, right? So your practice should carry all of those elements in some way or another. That means that if you talk only about the movement, it is very limited approach to life and practice. For example, we need to start, okay, every cell needs a certain boundary to protect its own DNA, protect your own memory. It has a boundary, but the boundary is open. It allows something in and allows something out. So the first element that we are talking about is, who am I, right? To this historically known question. So understanding ourselves is very, very important. Then we have this movement. Movement is not only I move, but I understand how to move with efficiency, how to produce a movement that gives me a lot of variabilities, that I can respond to different changes in environment. Then we can be talking about responsiveness, how responsive I am, how many variables in behavior can I produce in these changing circumstances. And then, of course, metabolism is about your energy management. But in the core of all of this is our homeostasis or allostasis, you know, how we maintain living functions. As Schrödinger said, living a little bit longer than expected to. So we are talking about what is the quest for better communication, because that's like the ultimate question that we have, how we can communicate better in life, how we can be more adjustable, how we can listen a little bit better. So this would be the most important imperative of the practice. And if you're practicing communication, then there is like plenty of areas that you can be exploring. And also the beauty about training in FM communication is that we can be sometimes using words, sometimes we can be using materials, sometimes we can be moving, but sometimes we can maybe do theater, sometimes we can work with the voice. So it has all these very important elements that are necessary for our lives. I wouldn't be interested in what is the range of the motion, or I would not be interested in how strong you are, but how does that element, how does that quality fits into your everyday life and what you can do with it. Yeah, maybe you're really strong, but your rhythm is so poor that you even cannot apply that strength in everyday situation.
It's fascinating when you say the word communication. The first idea which comes to mind is of course language. It's of course speaking, and this is probably the majority time that we spend communicating is actually through words, understanding language. But you bring in almost another perspective to communication, which is of course evident. We do communicate with bodies, we do communicate body language, and we know that. But actually during practice, we get a chance to experience those forms.
Like when we were talking about the Fighting Monkey Zero forms, we were talking that certain practices, they bring you more towards you, to understand better what is the my homeostasis, what is my unique biological signature, how I can be longer, a little bit healthy, how I can navigate myself through the world more, with more easiness, with more elegance, right? With more energetical surplus. And then there is this other part of Fighting Monkey that grows out of that desire to live, is these movement situations within which we are using really various tools. Maybe for the listeners to understand that we use different body practices, that like a grappling practices almost, or striking, or anything that really engage human bodies, communicate, collaborate, and compete together. We are also using something like a theatrical practice, this ability to write text, write script, create a world out of nothing, right? You create a parallel world, you imagine what could be, and so you're able to define that space in a really in three-dimensional, maybe a black cube of a theater. So we're using all those things, writing script, being able to perform another character, maybe perform many characters, maybe create a different scripts about my life. Then we have these compositional practices, how you compose your knowledge, what you do with your knowledge, what you do with this table and this cup, how you, do you place those things in a time space so they can be useful. When things are being clashed together, when they are very much close to each other, you almost cannot see them. So composition is very, very important. And another thing that we work with is that we articulate material. So on one way, when we talk about homeostasis, when we talk about health, when we talk about biological signature, we try to understand our own material, our own raw material, not only the material of five social forces, history, politics, culture, etc., religion and economy, something that we've been melted to, right? So something that culture approves, this is what means being a man, this is what means being successful, etc. No, going from this culturally valued object back into the raw material. Who am I, right? What do I want in the life? Not someone telling me what I should be doing or what should be and until when I should be reaching those goals. There is this reaching towards ourselves, but then also testing that knowledge in different situations, testing them in a different setups, like working with the external materials as well. So I do understand who I am also by sculpting other materials, stone, clay, using paint, using whatever material is available to you so you can understand better who you are.
So communicating to others through movement situation, communicating to objects. So also others, but like not other people, but other things, so to say. But also finding connections within what is my own body logic, if we can call it that way. Many times you said that we're close to finding the universal subcoordinative patterns, something which really sort of grounds most of athletic activities that a human being can do. Mm-hmm. And this for me also relates very much to what you speak of 8 special meridians.
You were talking about the subcoordinative pattern. So we are not interested in learning something that you can use only once, right? We would like to learn something that has many different applications. So we would study the evolutionary development of ongoing evolutionary development of our own bodies, right? So we see how I can understand what is the core of human motion and immediately understand we have 2 legs, we have 2 arms, we have 3 body weight centers, and we try to understand non-coding material. That means how do we move? We study how we're moving outside of the context of basketball, volleyball, or whatever sport you might call. So we are studying what are the mechanics, how we can be moving not only more efficiently, but also more creatively. How we can be using less power and more rhythm. How we can be articulating the human origami, right? Folding and unfolding our joints in such a way that we can enjoy really long life. But not only long life doing one thing, but enjoying long life with a lot of behavioral flexibility and a lot of proprioceptive variability, right? So there is an allowance of joints to do many different things. And also having that capacity to learn new things so that through these basic coordinative patterns that we've been working on, we understand the construct of human structure.
If we do love life and we do want to love life, it may mean that we want to find ourselves in very different scenarios, in very different situations, with different people, playing with different objects, different situations. And for that, we do need some self-understanding. How do I operate in those situations that, first of all, I don't get injured, I don't feel stupid, so to say. I know myself at least a little bit so that I can really go out and play there.
Your practice should offer you like a 3 basic building blocks. And the first one, very important, is that your practice should offer you feedback. Through that feedback, you should understand that you are in trouble or you're running into a trouble. And it's a different loop of feedbacks. It doesn't come only from you, within you. It always comes through relations that you build up. You have something that you can understand, but you can also understand some things through the others. And they are giving you that feedback. So creating kind of network that allows you to have a more appropriate feedback about what is happening to you, and also you can give birth to that kind of understanding. Then the second another important element of the practice is that you should have a tools to correct those errors. So you do some errors or something goes out of balance, you're able to recorrect it in some way. And the third element that your practice should have is the capacity to plan better for future. So if that experience, you remember it, you know if it works or it didn't work, and you can project in the future, and you can project also many scenarios. You create this deliberative process within which you kind of try to find out what are the variables of my behavior that could help me to overcome the challenging situation. You know, maybe it sounds all too abstract maybe for people that are listening to it, but it is like being an actor that can play many different roles. You are not only an actor that can play one role and kind of very habitually and very rigidly always repeat the same behavior. Someone asks you something, you behave the same way. Someone else asks you something and you still behave the same way. The world is asking you to change because maybe your age has changed, maybe the situation in your life has changed. You've been alone or now you have a partner, maybe you have your kids or maybe you lost someone. Practice should respond. So you are an actor that can play many different roles. You understand that situations are changing and so you can change with them. You are changing, but you do not forget yourself. You do not become fragmented. This is when we were telling about don't forget who you are. What is your self-authorizing epistemology? What is your understanding of yourself? What is your autobiography? So in a time of crisis, you remember who you are. So it's not only that you're always changing with the new environmental stimuli, you're able to change, you are able to change different roles, you can move in very different ways, you can produce many different qualities, but you do not lose yourself. And what is also beautiful that not only that you are not losing yourself, but you understand that self, it's not something that can be clearly defined, it is always fluctuating, it is always a little bit changing, and it's very good if we pay attention to those changes outside but also inside of ourselves.
The changes, the crisis and the need to adapt are so often talked about subjects, so to say, but in different circumstances, like in business, yeah, in politics, in economics, we do the physical practice and through that we study our own adaptability and our own, well, ability to change and to respond. This brings in the question of this mind and body connection somehow.
There is no mind and body, it's just one thing, right?
Exactly, it's one thing, but might be fascinating at first is finding yourself reacting in a movement situation in a certain way and later actually noticing that, hey, this is how I reacted to a new situation, a practice ball flying towards me or being tightened by the belt and pulled by my leg. And then I realized that, hey, probably this is the way I would react in some other scenario which is not movement related. So this somehow does invite a thought that probably the structure of our mind, the structure of the way we use language and we respond to environment is also ingrained into the way we move and through
experience, very good. Particular wiring that you have just responds to the environment with which you are in, right? The interactions that you've been part of, the communicative patterns that you've been part of. So, you know, like you don't think differently than what you really experience. So what is interesting there when we are practicing it is with what material do you practice? Do you practice with the tools that are predictable? Do you practice with the tools that can be used only in one way? Or you use the what we call abstract tools in Fighting Monkey, or use the tools that are not very easy to grasp, tools that are not easy to handle, tools that are, they have multiple applications. So, you know, that's what I would like to define. For example, when we've been working with wooden beams, the wooden beams is only one wooden beam that we've been manipulating is only 60-70 kilograms, which is really a low weight, but it allows you to play in many different ways and you can build up a kind of adaptive strength. And also what is beautiful with that low weight, you do not burden your joints. You add complexity, you add variability to your practice and not the weight only. We were discussing also this. Do I stay work with the weight and I'm becoming strong? Or I'm becoming strong, like we were saying, I'm lifting the weight, or I'm lifting the human being, or I'm lifting the human being that doesn't want to be lifted. And when we do this research with freestyle wrestlers, and we say, okay, how you build up your strength? Do you build up your strength by lifting a dead weight, or you build up your strength lifting someone who doesn't want to be lifted? This is kind of more adaptive strength, better intelligence in the entire physical structure. Of course, everyone's life is different. But I sense that I am doing much better when I can communicate in many different ways. When I train to communicate, when my physical body is not placed into some kind of boxes and some kind of, oh, I do 6 repetitions, 5 times, 5 series. I'm not interested in that type of training. I'm interested in evolving communication. For some people, they need a certainty, but I have enough of energy and enough of interest in life to work with uncertainty, to work with probability. We have to leave certainty for kind of older physics. Now we are living a contemporary physics that requires a different look at the universe around us.
I think your work brings in the question, very actual question, a standing question, so to say, can we really study communication and our relations to the world without a physical experience? And probably the answer is no, we cannot. And some philosophers do speak of us coming into this world, first of all, physically, and through our spatial orientation, through walking through landscape,
yes.
We do get cognitive abilities, and longer in life, evolving in life, we shall not forget that.
John Dewey, right? It's the beginning of last century. He was saying quest for certainty. I think that was the name of the book. We look for something immutable, something that is stable, because that is also in philosophy was like this is like a absolute truth, right? But when we talk about biology, when we talk about movement, it's, you are looking for change, not for stability. And also there is something, another very important or interesting element. You have pain in your belly. Okay, I give you a pill and it works very well. And then I go to Katya or any other person that is around me, and he's also pain in the, or she has a pain in the belly. I give the pill. It doesn't work. Why? It's the same pill. Worked on you, but didn't work on her. You know, so we need to understand the complexity of the human beings with which we are. Not looking for a certain answers, but maybe only probabilities, not false promises. You know, we play together and we see what happens. We see what you are capable to come up with.
Embracing mystery.
Yes, in some way, of yourself. We always know what this body is, you know, but from the top of our heads to bottom of our feet, this is, we already understand a lot of mechanisms thanks to a good science. We understand a lot of things, but a lot of things are also unknown. And if we enter into the world of also of the practice, also of the physical practice, through this more not knowing attitude than knowing attitude, we might discover some maybe better idea than good. You know, we are so happy with good. But this openness to uncertainty, and we really hate uncertainty, we can discover really maybe better ideas to achieve those in sport, maybe these higher performances, etc. Many times we ask athletes when they have a trouble, they cannot perform well, so we ask them to become stronger. And many times the solution is, no, don't make them stronger, just allow them to be more rhythmically organized, allow them to have more rhythm, better coordination, so they can utilize that power in a more efficient way. Rather than making them stronger, more stiff, and then forcing them to have more injuries, depleting them. But of course, we are the people probably that are prescribing those methods to other people. Maybe they have a little understanding in their own bodies. What does it mean, rhythm and coordination? Many people claim I'm a mover, but really go from one side of the room to another and move. And then many times you see, oh, people are not moving, they are doing exercises, they are doing some kind of combos. So interesting. People say, we are doing the animal movement. Yes, but you are not really doing animal movement, you're really just doing some silly exercises, silly moving choreographies that do not reflect anything about human emotion. But we like that, you know, we like that because we know there is this, what we were talking about, what makes us to repeat those things, because there's some kind of security. I understand it and I master it.
A sense of achievement, probably.
Yes, probably. But also what really is secure in our life. How do you practice today if you do not know what tomorrow brings? Everyone kind of trains for certainty. But you have to ask guys from special forces. You have to ask guys from firefighters. You have to ask medics. There is always something goes wrong. Usually things are going more wrong than how we expected them. There is always a kind of B plan. And how early can adapt to that B plan? There was this very interesting thing in evolution. You know, we think adaptation is the best thing, but if you adapt too well to the environment, then maybe you might lose some of the traits that might be very important in a time of changes. So what is really truly adaptable is your capacity to react to changes, to change something in your behavior when something changes. But what I see many times in practitioner, something changes in your life and you do not even notice. You think this diet is perfect, but you are changing. Seasons are changing. You're aging, so your metabolism is different. Can you notice those changes and so change your diet? There's always someone coming with some really great ideas what to eat. Instead of eat whatever you want, but you really need to understand your constitution or what is available to you and how to prepare that food and how to spend time with that food. And maybe in this period, the meat would be okay. Maybe in some other period, it needs to be something else, but we only follow these prescribed ideas. We leave the world of ideas. We do not really listen to ourselves. We do not really see what is the context within which we operate.
If I think of the biggest learning from the mentorship process that we took for the last 10 months, is probably, first of all, understanding how much there is to be known and how much there is unknown that we cannot probably describe so easy. So it's not that it's only me that I don't know, but people in general don't know many things about what body is and how it should be treated and what health is and why do we age and why do we ultimately die and what's the right way to move and so on and so on. But the biggest learning out of it is that, hey, I've got to listen. I've got to be attentive to what is there now in this particular context, in this particular situation, and really be open to test and to taste possible solutions and to try out and not to be afraid to change if necessary. Yeah. Of course, not forgetting where I'm coming from, but also speculate different possible futures.
Yes.
So that was a big learning.
But when you talk about health, you know, we think that health is absence of illness. But it is not so. You know, you will eventually get sick, you will eventually die. So maybe what we have to redefine the health by, I have a people, I build up a kind of meaningful network that will help me to overcome the troubles. So when I get sick, maybe there is someone around that allows me to go through. And also we need to know that something that is out of balance, something that is not exactly what we might perceive as healthy, gives a rise to something so beautiful as art. Because there is something out of whack in me, something doesn't work so well, so I see the world in a very unique way. That's what allows me, maybe my melancholy, maybe my instability, maybe my fear, can give a birth to most beautiful artful pieces, poetry, music, cinema, fine art, sculpting. So not only this cleanness within which, oh, I need to be healthy. Sometimes when I create work, I might not sleep well for a few weeks, but that not sleeping time is this creative, maybe even painful, but kind of creative time when I really try to solve it, I dream about it. It's like falling in love, but it's kind of painful falling in love. And it's not like you need to suffer when you create, but and you search for that solution and it's just cooking in you, and then you wake up and suddenly it is there. It needs that pressure, it needs the time of balance that is also necessary. Not only this, that perfect balancedness, you know, sometimes having pain in the knee is great. Sometimes, you know, you overdone something and you are really aching in your lower back. It is good. It is just question how often you go off balance and what you can harness out of that experience.
It's probably the whole culture that we have created is born out of unnecessary childish games and we are back to playfulness, right? Doing something unnecessary, something extra, experimenting, looking towards the sky and staring at the rainbows. And maybe that's also the birth of wonder and the birth of science, of philosophy. It seems that in our practice, we take a lot of inspiration from fighting and also a lot of inspiration from dance. Those are seemingly two opposite occupations that a human being can take. Almost dancing is about celebrating and communicating with cooperativeness, and fighting is something where you sort of solve the problem of non-cooperation, or you have non-cooperative partner. But it seems like when you move and when we move together with you, dance and fight in terms of movement, it's very close.
I'm not a fighter myself, even though you know that I visit the coaches for wrestling or boxing or some other martial arts, because I'm interested in rhythm. I try to understand what is that capacity to react and communicate in those very tight situations. Of course, every coach that I met said, please dance. Like, can you produce a different rhythms? Can you be surprising to your opponent? So. And also, you know, like the rhythmicality, the dance quality, that openness allows you to pass over that really difficult time within which you need every drop of the energy, right? So if you are stiff, if you are rigid, if you cannot respond, that I think that's the end of the game. So that kind of looseness, cooperation of the whole body, not isolated power, but power that is taking the whole structure into motion, taking yourself with yourself, being able to disappear, being able to flow and understand the partner's intention and maybe not go against the biggest power, but kind of flow around it and find the escape is probably ultimate goal of every artist, every fighter.
How did you like your stay in Vilnius? What did you experience? And what would you wish for our community who practice movement, first of all, but through movement, communication, and they study self? What would you wish for us?
First of all, thank you very much for your invitation. I feel so connected to this land. That's like similar land within which I grew as a child. So I was very pleased. You've done a really great job. So people knew what they are stepping into. They were ready to take the complexity of the training that we are doing, because you know that we don't do step one, you complete the step one, step two, you complete the step two, this kind of additional training, but we are more working with people as complex human beings that they are capable of learning in complex environment. They are wonderful people. I mean, I have to probably learn more from them than they learning from me. So what I wish more encounters, so we can meet more often and work together and speculate together and maybe create that kind of moving philosophy, moving poetry together, being inspired to go on, you know, because as we will be growing, as we will be aging, there will be more and more difficulties that will maybe come into our lives, and we will have to be increasingly creative in order to keep the window of plasticity open, so we can be still empathic, so we can search for new, learn for the sake of learning, right? Being happy to just be learning and be with other people. So to you, I wish a lot of energy surplus so you can stay creative, and for your students as well. And I think you've done really excellent job.
Thank you. I'm curious to see where this journey
will take us.
Can take us, yes.